Good morning. Welcome to Castleton United Methodist Church. We're so glad you're here with us today, here on the first week of Advent. Would you stand and worship with us this morning? Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, hail thee as the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround thee, earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee, center of unbroken praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, blossoming meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee.
Fulfillment of God's promise and the hope that is ours in Jesus Christ. Today we light the first candle of Advent. We light the candle of hope. We long for your coming, Lord Jesus. We invite you to break through our clutter and to come and reign among us. Restore our hope and renew us through your presence. We rejoice in the promises of God, and we take delight in God's willingness to provide us with the light of hope.
I'm going to teach you a chorus to this song, Joyful, Joyful. I'll sing it once, and then if you could sing along, that'd be awesome.
Joyful, joyful, we are joyful. Because you are, yes, you are, you are. Joy, joyful, joyful, we are joyful. Because you are, yes, you are joy. Mortals join the mighty chorus, which the morning stars proclaim. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music lifts us onward in the triumph song of life. Joyful, joyful, we are joyful. Because you are, yes, you are joy. Joyful, joyful, we are joyful. Because you are, yes, you are joy.
You may be seated. If you would, please turn your attention to the screen. We have a short video.
We learned that Mary gave us a present too.
You
brought baby Jesus a gift?
Yes.
Oh, you are so...
Yes, it's just love.
The annual Live Nativity is a major gift we give to our community. Lots of volunteers are needed to present our reenactment celebrating the birth of Jesus. Right after this service is a great time to sign up. Look for the Live Nativity tables in the narthex. Be part of the lessons and memories that can help influence generations.
United Methodist Church has been a part of Mission Guatemala for the last 4 years since it started. We have supported it with our prayer, our gifts, and our time. This year, we sent a team of adults and students, which worked on kitchens and showing God's love to the children in the communities. Mission Guatemala partners with the communities to establish what is needed, and the communities all provide some level of sweat equity in the projects. They do all the work with the end goal of self-sustainability for the community. The people you will meet will inspire you to come home and be a game changer in this community. Our next two trips are in October 2015 and June 2016. If you would like more information on either one of the trips, plan on attending the information meeting on December 7th after the 11 a.m. service. Thanks.
Well, as I said, good morning. We are so glad that you're here with us today. We believe here at Castleton that you are all here for a reason this morning, that God brought you here this morning to be with us. If you're a guest here this morning, would you please take the welcome, green welcome folder, whatever we want to call them, on the ends of the pews, and would you pass those down and fill those out? We have a few announcements. The first one is pick a star in the legacy room out in the narthex. You'll find more information about our Pick a Star program, sponsoring kids and gifts for Christmas. Our second announcement is that we need volunteers for our hospitality team. Pastor Billy is in charge of that, and he will gladly accept more volunteers for our hospitality ministry because we are in need. Our third announcement is gift wrapping, Christmas gift wrapping. We have over at Stillwaters in the Ministry Center, they will be wrapping gifts, I believe, until the 22nd of December. Between 7:30 and 10:30 in the morning, you can bring in your gifts, and they will wrap your gifts for you. If you would like to be a gift wrapper, that would be awesome to go and volunteer at Stillwaters. Would you stand and greet one another at this time?
I just think, man, Joe's up here looking bad anyway, so.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs implore. plains. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Repeat the sounding joy. Joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well. No tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, it never lets me go. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the name the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love. Joy, unspeakable joy. Joy, unspeakable joy, an overflowing well, no tongue can tell. Joy, unspeakable joy, it rises in my soul, it never lets me. Joy, it rises in my soul, it never lets me go.
Amen. You may be seated. Well, now is the time for our offering. Here at Castleton, we believe in cheerful giving. In this time of Advent and prayer, we want to focus on praying for the next year, for our budget next year, as we talked about in the past few weeks, and going into our next year of financial giving. And I know that some of you have received your pledge cards. Some of you may not have received your pledge cards, but if not, you can grab them at the church office, or you can go online. There's a way online to sign up for your pledge. If the ushers would please come forward, we'll go into our time of offering.
Tore the night apart and ripped the silent skies in half. Your glory breaking through the dark. And here our worlds collide, divinity in man confined. This great design drawn out for me. You man knew well, God with us. You man knew well, hallelujah. You hold the end of time, you place yourself here into my life is now forever change. Our eyes be lifted up, our great eternal hope arise. This great design drawn out for me. Amen.
Good morning. Our scripture lesson for the morning comes from the Gospel of St. Luke, the first chapter. Hear now the word of the Lord. Once when Zechariah's division was on duty and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshipers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I am an old man, and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I have been sent to speak to you and to tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Well, let's pray. Lord, I pray that over the next few moments, you would give me the words that are needed to share. And Lord, I pray that over the next few weeks, that you would give us some tools for the toolbox when it comes to prayer. Pray that you would answer the same prayer that we pray, that your disciples prayed. Lord, teach us how to pray. Help us to be a people who are fervent in prayer. And Lord, I just pray that you would bless our church as we seek to become prayer saturated. And we know that our prayers do make a difference. There are so many needs, there are so many people that are looking for answers. And Lord, we pray that you would enable us to be a house of prayer. Because we know that when we're a house of prayer, we'll be a house of power. And that power will be a solution to many people's problems. The power of God at work in their lives and in their situations. Have your own way, Lord. Have your own way. You are the potter. Help us to be clay. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, we're starting a new sermon series today, and I'm going to hang around up here at the pulpit so that I don't leap around too much. My doctor's report is that I do have a torn Achilles, and for now we're going to try and treat that with just medicine and not doing too much on it. So y'all keep me in your prayers. I did get a good, I knew I had to ask the doctor this because my wife would say, "Are you sure?" But I did ask the doctor, and the doctor told me I could go fishing. And so that's where I'm headed. And so y'all pray for me, and I'll be praying for you, and we'll leave you in great, capable hands with Pastor Billy. So I want to talk about prayer. And I like preaching about prayer and talking about prayer. And I wish that when I was younger, that someone had preached more on some practical steps that I could do to further develop my own personal prayer life. So today I want to give some practical tips that will help you as an individual and help us corporately as a body to become a prayer-saturated church. The question that I would ask if I were sitting where you are is, why in Advent would you preach about prayer? I mean, of all the subjects that you could preach about in preparation for the coming of the Lord, why would you choose prayer? Well, I'm so glad you thought to ask me that. Because one of our goals is to raise the prayer temperature of our church by becoming a prayer-saturated congregation. Now, prayer is foundational to everything that we do. At least prayer should be foundational to everything that we do. Prayer is one of our core values as a church family. And you know the other two, right? Prayer is one of our core values, and the other one is? Family. And the third one? Mission and outreach. Because I knew you all need them. You just didn't want to be the one bragging. So our core values, prayer, families, mission and outreach. And part of our core value of prayer, we've entered into this 40-day prayer challenge. And can I just give a plug right now? It's not too late to join. If you've not become part of the 40-day prayer challenge and you want to join, and I'll even go so far as to say, if you're here today and you want to become part of that prayer challenge, and maybe you didn't bring the, I don't know what the books are, $6, $7, just take a book and sign your name by it, and I'll pay for the book. Okay? I'll take it out of Pastor Billy's salary. and just take the book, and there's a little handy-dandy guide on there, and you've already blown the guide, so forget about the guide and just get started. And we're more interested in you doing the book than we are keeping the schedule, okay? So you can get started with that. Prayer is foundational, everything we do, and we want to become a prayer-saturated church. Well, what does that mean, to become prayer-saturated? In my world, being prayer-saturated means that, first of all, Christ is exalted through prayer, that we exalt Christ through the ministry of prayer, that God's mission, and the mission is making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, that we understand that that can only be accomplished as we pray. And so Pastor Billy and others are right when they say, no one ever comes to this church by accident, but by divine appointment. We believe that we literally pray people into this place. And that you're here this morning. If you're here and you go, I don't know why I picked this church. Well, let me tell you why. Because we prayed you in here. We prayed you in here. And we know that this is a place for blessing. And if you came with a burden, if you came with a need, we'll be glad to help you pray through that need for the blessings of God. Well, also, there is nothing more important or more sustaining for developing a healthy church than deepening our personal and our corporate prayer lives. If you want the church to be healthy, if you want the church to look like what Jesus said it should look like, his description of the church is this. He said, my house shall be called a house of fish fries. No, he said, my house shall be called, I love the fish fry, by the way. He said, my house shall be called a house of prayer for all nations. Phil Yancey, a Christian writer, teacher, says this, prayer equips us to carry out the work of God. Prayer launches us into the work of God and helps us to make God's visible on earth. The question is, why don't we pray more? Why don't we pray more? Now, when I say that, automatically I have to become defensive, because what I didn't say is that we don't pray. We do pray. Amen? We pray. But why don't we pray more? And what I mean by that is, if you were to call a prayer meeting, if we were just to announce right now that we're going to have a prayer meeting this week, I guarantee you that the attendance is going to drop. I mean, there's not going to be a whole lot of people that just rush out. And that's where we want to get to, the place that when we call a prayer meeting, more people are more interested in coming to prayer than they are any other service, because prayer is what fuels the church. Amen. So, why don't we pray more? Many people do not believe that prayer works because they've never experienced the benefits of prayer. Well, I'm here to tell you that prayer works. I don't know how people can live without a constant barraging of heaven with their prayers. Most people have never been taught or instructed how to pray. I mean, it's not something that we have a Sunday school class that says, teach us how to pray. Maybe we should. But we've not done that. In a lot of our seminaries, our pastors, and I'm one, our pastors are not trained how to pray. We don't have classes. We have a very few classes on prayer, and those are elective classes. Just so happened I went to a seminary where that was not an elective. You had to take classes in prayer. And I'm so glad that I was kind of forced into taking some classes on prayer. And what I found is that prayer is the most indispensable in the church. We need prayer. Most people have never been taught or instructed how to pray. Many are hindered in prayer by sin and find it difficult to pray because of unforgiveness or guilt. And so people say, I'm not good enough to pray because I did this or I have this problem, and so we feel like we can't approach a holy God because of who we are. Well, listen, it's not based on who we are. It's based on who he is, amen? And the Bible says about him, he's slow to anger, that he abounds in steadfast love, and that he's always open to hear your prayers and my prayers. We often fail to plan or schedule a time for prayer. I'm talking about why we don't pray more. We oftentimes fail to plan or schedule a time for prayer. Some people believe that prayer is only for those super saints or for those who are more spiritual. Well, I'm here to tell you, I'm not a super saint. I did expect somebody to say amen on that, but that's okay. Y'all are being kind. You're being kind. Thank you. I'm not a super saint. I'm a sinner, just like you all. But I need prayer, and prayer is indispensable. It's a value in my life. But some people believe that because I'm not, you know, and you could, don't stick anybody's name in here that's here, but some super saint, I'm not Billy Graham, I'm not Mother Teresa. How's that? We can use those. Those are safe. That therefore I can't pray because I'm not as good as those folks are. Some see prayer as only, you know, a self-help technique that, well, maybe it doesn't really work. It just makes you feel better about it if you think you're talking to God about it. Yeah. I've found out that when I pray, things happen, and when I don't pray, they don't happen. Sometimes people are confused between corporate prayer and personal prayer. And so no prayer is prayed except during emergencies or crisis situations. And there is a difference between corporate prayer and personal prayer. I've had people say to me over the years, well, Pastor, why do we need to come to church and have a prayer meeting? Doesn't the Bible tell us to pray at home in our closet, to have our personal space, a prayer closet? And my answer is yes, the Bible tells us that. And then it also tells us that we need to come together. The early church modeled that. In fact, before the early church was ever born, get this now, before the early church was ever born, they started in a prayer meeting. They went to Jerusalem after the crucifixion, after the resurrection, after the ascension of Jesus. They went to a prayer meeting in the upper room. And the church was born out of a prayer meeting. It was out of that meeting that the power of God hit that church on the day of Pentecost, and they literally exploded into the world. And my prayer is, Lord, do it again. Lord, do it again. Sometimes people get confused between corporate prayer and personal prayer. And so no prayer is prayed, except during emergencies or crisis situations. I believe that's because prayer is hard work. Prayer is hard work. That's another good place to say amen. Prayer is hard work. Now, having said that, let me give the disclaimer. Prayer is hard work, but prayer is easy. Prayer is simple. It's simple because it's simply talking, communicating with God. It's talking to and listening to God, but it's the hardest thing you'll ever do. Why? I'll get back to that in a minute, because there's an enemy that wants to keep you distracted. I'm going to show you some ways that the devil tries to distract you from praying. But here's a few suggestions, a few tips and tools for the toolbox to strengthen your prayer life. First of all, make prayer an appointment. Make prayer an appointment. If you don't make it an appointment, it will become a disappointment because you'll be disappointed that you don't have time to do it. Set it just like you would say, okay, Friday night, I'm going out on a date. Okay? Set a time. Set a time and look forward to that time. Start small. Here's what I mean by starting small. If you don't pray regular routine, don't say, okay, tomorrow I'm going to pray for 1 hour. I'm going to pray for an hour if it kills me, because it will kill you. If you're not used to it and if you're not ready, you've got to start small. It'd be better to say, tomorrow I'm going to pray for 5 minutes. And in 2 days, I'm going to increase that to 7 minutes. And then I'm going to pray for 9 minutes. Okay? Start small. Don't start big and then get defeated and just give up. Start small. Here's another good tip. find a quiet place. Find a place where you're free from distractions. Find a quiet place. And then prime the pump. Listen, do we have anybody here that used to have pumps in their yard or pumps in their home outside? No, anybody? Any pump people? Okay, you prime the pump because why? After going dry, you can pump all you want, but you're not getting any water out of there. And so you prime the pump, and it gets that little thing inside called the sucker, okay? It gets, I don't know if that's really the name of it. It seems like an appropriate name. Anyways, you put that in there, and pretty soon you get water. So then you fill the prime container back up, and then you got all the water that you need. Here's what I mean in prayer when we talk about priming the pump. You might read a passage of Scripture and then just think about that passage and just listen for the voice of God to speak to you. You might read a devotional. You might get a hymn book or have a CD player with some praise music, gospel, whatever kind of music you like that gets you in the presence of God. And that's what I mean by priming the pump. Get you in a position where you're ready to pray and spend some time in God's presence. Pray aloud. Pray loud enough for you to hear it, especially when you're praying the Scriptures. I didn't say pray loud, but pray loud enough for you to hear it. And there's something about hearing yourself pray, especially if you're praying the Scriptures. And here's what I mean by praying the Scriptures. Let's say, okay, my favorite psalm is Psalm 1. So I pray that psalm quite a bit. And so the Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly or stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law, and on his law, on God's law, he meditates day and night. So I will pray, Lord, help me to be that kind of man. Help me to be a man whose roots go deep so that I can have fruit for the kingdom of God. And see, and as you pray that, it's getting it in your head and in your heart that, yeah, that's what I want. I want the Scripture of God to come true in my life. Use a model or a system as a guide for praying. Use a model or a system as a guide to praying. Sometimes that means writing your prayers out. A guide is something like this. Y'all heard this. The Acts, A-C-T-S, like the book of Acts, A-C-T-S, adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. That's a model for how to pray. You begin by saying adoration. Lord, I adore you. I bless you for who you are. Lord, you're the God of the universe. You created the whole world. Lord, you're wonderful. You're displayed in the heavens and, you know, adoration. And then confession. Lord, forgive me. I'm sorry. Thanksgiving, Lord, thank you for the turkey that we got, woohoo, and for whatever, you know, thanksgiving. And then supplication, Lord, we need your help. Aunt Betty's sick and she needs to be healed. And, you know, supplication, you pray for God to supply our needs. I like the cats. You've heard me say this before. I like cats. Confession, adoration, thanksgiving, supplication. Just because of my own personality style, there's not a big difference between acts and cats, except this. I like going into the presence of God and getting things cleaned up right away. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So I like going in the presence of God with a clean slate. That's just me. Your personality may be different. But the point is using a different type of model, using a model to help. And then keep a prayer list. Keep a prayer list. How many of y'all know that I have a photographic memory? Did y'all know that? Well, I got a photographic memory. I just don't have a disc in the camera. Oh, bad joke. Okay, move on. No, I don't have a photographic memory. And so I can't remember all the stuff that I should be praying about. So you make a prayer list. You start a list. And then the neat thing about having a list is as the prayers get answered, you can go back and you can check those off. And you can check them off and you can say, woo, God came through on that one. God came through on this one. Okay, the answer was no on this one. Or I got to wait a while on this one. And so you continue to pray and you build your prayer list. And then when you're praying for people, be specific. But now listen to this. If you don't get anything else, get this out of the message. When you're specific, only be specific in your private, personal time, okay? When you're praying corporate prayers, you don't need to go into a great deal of detail, okay? You need me to say more about that? When you're praying personal, it's okay to say, Lord, you know, Uncle Joe, he really needs a job. And Lord, please bless him because, and you can go into the details about Uncle Joe. But when you're praying corporately, you don't want to pray and put Uncle Joe's business out in the street, okay? You want to be respectful. You want to pray, Lord, help Uncle Joe. He's having a hard time and he needs a job. That's sufficient, okay? You don't need to go in all the details. You know, Lord, they're threatening to foreclose on his house and they don't have any food in the cabinet and, you know, you understand what I'm saying? Y'all still there? Okay, all right, I'm almost done. Remember, prayer does not need to be wordy or lengthy to be considered prayer or to be effective. I mean, how foolish is it to sit here and pray, oh, Lord God, thou who dost know that this building is burning. No, you pray, fire, help! It doesn't need to be wordy or lengthy or theologically sounding to be considered prayer. The Bible says if we want our prayers to be effective, here's what it says in the book of James, the fifth chapter. It says the effectual fervent prayers, let me translate that. The effective fervent prayers, that is prayers that are God-honoring, God-centered, done with passion, done with sincerity, the effectual fervent prayers of the righteous. Now, let me put an asterisk by that. Because it's not our righteousness. It's the righteousness of Christ living and dwelling in us. It's the righteousness of God in us that makes our prayers effective. Amen? The effectual fervent prayers of the righteous avails much, accomplishes much. And it's the righteousness of Christ working in us. Prayer, we learn from Zechariah, God looks at our hearts and not just at our words or our wordiness or lack thereof. And God can translate the words of our heart. Now, Zechariah was a priest and we read that story and he had a specific prayer request. He wanted a son. And God answered that prayer. Let me ask you, are your prayers specific or are your prayers pacific? Because if they're specific, they'll get to the point. But if they're pacific, they'll be as wide as the ocean. Are you praying for something specific or pacific? Have you circled it? Would be the language of our prayer challenge. Have you circled it? And are you serious about it? Now, having said that, I want to remind all of us. I remind myself of this all the time. God is sovereign. But God has also told us through Jesus that we should ask, that we should seek, and that we should knock, and that we should keep on asking and seeking and knocking. But God is sovereign. And sometimes God answers yes, sometimes God answers no, and sometimes God answers wait. The success of our God work, that is the things that we do as Christians and as a church, depends on our being connected to God. In other words, prayer is our direct link and our source of real power. Now, get this. I'm going to share this quote with you. It's by Samuel Chadwick. And this is a quote worth taking home. Okay, if you don't take anything else home with you, make sure you take this one home with you. The devil does not care how much you preach, teach, give, serve, read, or cry, but the devil trembles when you pray. Isn't that good? I like that. The devil doesn't care how much you preach, teach, give, serve, read, cry, but the devil trembles when you pray. And I would add to that, that the weakest Christian is stronger than all the powers of darkness. The weakest Christian is stronger than the powers of darkness. Jesus said it this wise, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in you, that is Jesus, than he that is in the world, Satan or the devil. But the devil's solution is to try and trick you because he is a deceiver. He will do anything to keep you from praying. Now, some of you started this 40-day challenge, and I dare say some of you, not all of you, but some of you have found it difficult to keep that up. I want to just give you a little insight that part of that is that there's a spirit that would war against you getting closer to Jesus. There's a spirit that would come against you when you seek to deepen your spiritual roots. So just be aware of that and don't give up. Don't quit. Don't faint. Don't say, I can't do this. You can do it. Hang in there. And if you continue on, the blessings are going to be yours. So the devil will try to do anything to keep you from praying. The devil will also try to provide a sense of false security or self-sufficiency. Oh, you don't need to pray. You're okay. You don't need prayer. Or to provide unrealistic expectations of prayer and self. And so you pray unrealistic prayers. And sometimes the devil makes things hectic and crazy to sidetrack us from praying. Sometimes prayer seems like drudgery, and so it doesn't seem like there's any joy in it. But I want to just encourage you to press through, because there is joy in prayer. The other thing the devil tries to do is to keep us ignorant concerning the power and help that the Holy Spirit can provide. In fact, the Bible says it on this way. There are times when we don't even know how to pray. It's at that time when we just surrender that up to God that the Holy Spirit will intercede for us with groans and with utterances. The Holy Spirit himself will intercede for us and will teach us how to pray, and will pray as we lift up our concerns to the Lord. Sometimes there are no words. I mean, when you hear of some tragic event that takes place and it's especially touching your heart, and you just say, oh, merciful Lord. Oh, Lord, I don't even know what to say. Lord, have mercy. Lord, be present with that family. Lord, bless them as they go through this. Lord, help them. I mean, you don't even have the words, but as you pray, the Holy Spirit prays for you and on your behalf. Mark Batterson, in his little book, Draw the Circle, is right. He says, if you press into God's presence like never before, you will experience God like never before. If you pray through, God will break through in new ways. And then he says this, I love this. He says, the greatest tragedy in life is the prayers that go unanswered simply because they go unasked. Don't be afraid to pray boldly and to ask God. Never underestimate the power of a single prayer. Zechariah prayed, his wife prayed, and God came through, and God blessed. There are countless people throughout the Bible that prayed, and God came through. There's no such thing as a place where you can't pray. You can pray if you're in a dungeon. Amen. Paul and Silas were in a dungeon, and they prayed, and God came through. Jonah was in the belly of a big fish. I think it was a whale, but he was in the belly of a big fish, the Bible said, and he prayed, and his prayers came through. There's countless examples throughout the Bible of people in various positions, and they prayed, and God came through. Daniel, down in the lion's den, prayed, but the prayers got through. The children of Egypt, enslaved, down in slaves and in shackles and forced work, they prayed, but their prayers got through. We could have some fun and just go through this thing, but I won't. But know this, that when we pray, God hears our prayers. God hears our prayers. And God honors our prayers. And we're called to a ministry of intercessory prayer on behalf of our lives, our families, and on behalf of the world. The Bible says we should always pray and not faint. Pray and don't give up. Pray and seek help from the Lord. Well, let's pray. Lord, we're grateful and thankful again for the opportunity just to get some tips and tools for the toolbox. And I pray that you would help us to become a prayer-saturated congregation. Thank you, Lord. Forgive us for the times that we failed to spend in your presence. with any situation, any problem. Forgive us for the time, Lord, that we've been so arrogant to think we've got this and we don't need your help. Lord, we stretch our hands to you because there's no other help that we know. Our help comes from you, and we want to acknowledge that. And Lord, I pray that you would help me as the leader of this flock, along with Pastor Billy. Help us, Lord, to be men of prayer. And Lord, I pray that you would give us the time that we need to pray, to not get distracted by all the other demands of our job, that we forget to have time spent in your presence. Because, Lord, that's worth a whole lot more than a committee meeting. And I pray that you would help us to be aware of that and to spend the time we need with you. Thank you again for this day, and thank you for each person that's here. I pray that this Advent season would be a time when we would learn more about prayer, and we would indeed become prayer saturated. Let this become a house of prayer. In your name we ask, and we thank you in advance. Amen. Let's stand together, shall we?
Sing, O come, Emmanuel. O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations, bind in one the hearts of all mankind. Bid thou our sad division cease, and be thyself a king of peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Amen. I know you have appreciated the ministry of our praise team together today. That you guys don't look as nice without the ladies, but you did a great job, so thank you. Would you receive the benediction? Lord, we're grateful and thankful that you've called us to be a house of prayer, and we pray that you would help us to become truly prayer saturated. Lord, that you would give us the things that we need to be great intercessors. Not so that we can say that we're a house of prayer, but because there's so many needs in our society and in our world. And Lord, you are alone have the power to make the lasting changes And so we pray that in obedience to the scripture, in obedience to who we are called to be, that you would help us to be a people of prayer. Dismiss us now with your blessing, never from your presence. Lead us and guide us into the world that we might be the light of Christ to a darkened world. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Thanks, guys.